In the series of these 10-minute talks that are sequenced alphabetically, we've reached the letter I. Today's talk is about the Independent Order of Odd Fellows, a fraternal organization that dates back to the 18th century. I am speaking to you today from the third floor of the former IOOF building in downtown Carlisle on West High Street. The first floor of the building houses the Cumberland County Historical Society's shop, known as History on High, the shop. The history of the building is complicated, but before talking about that, I would like to discuss what the Independent Order of Odd Fellows is. And I use the present tense because the organization is still alive and well across the world, although it ceased to exist in Carlisle in 1991. We are fortunate to have regalia from IOOF chapters in our museum. These include items from the Bowmansdale organization, in which the Carlisle organization merged in 1991, the African-American organization known as the GUOOF here in Carlisle, and we'll look at some of those items a little later in this talk. The IOOF, also known as Odd Fellows or the Triple Link Fraternity, began in England in the 18th century. It first appeared officially in the United States in Baltimore in 1819, when Thomas Waldy founded the order there. His order was authorized through the Independent Order of Odd Fellows, Manchester Unity, in England. The order established its own U.S.-based governance in 1842, and the organization came here to Carlisle in 1843. As with most organizations of this type, the order was originally open to membership for white men only. However, a branch for women was organized in 1851. African Americans formed their own version of the organization known as the Grand United Order of Odd Fellows in 1842, thus the letters G-U-O-O-F. And it maintained its contact with the English order. Beyond fraternal and recreational activities, the order promotes ethic of reciprocity and charity by implied inspiration of Judeo-Christian ethics. There are currently 600,000 members in 26 countries worldwide. IOOF was part of the golden age of fraternalism in America. They became the largest fraternal organization in the country, even surpassing Freemasonry. By 1889, there were lodges in every state in the country. The objectives of the Odd Fellows are, and this is the current listing of objectives, number one, to improve and elevate the character of mankind by promoting the principles of friendship, love, truth, faith, hope, charity, and universal justice. Number two, to help make the world a better place to live by aiding each other in times of need and by organizing charitable projects and activities that would benefit the less fortunate, the youth, the elderly, the environment, and the community in every way possible. Number three, to promote goodwill and harmony amongst peoples and nations through the principles of universal fraternity, holding the belief that all men and women, regardless of race, nationality, religion, social status, gender, rank, and station, are brothers and sisters. And number four, to promote a wholesome fraternal experience without violence, vices, and discrimination of every form. As with other similar organizations, there are initiation rites and various degrees or levels of membership. The degree includes initiatory, symbolized with the color white, friendship, symbolized with pink, and we have an example of one of the robes that we got from the Bowmansdale organization showing that second level, the pink level, brotherly love, which is blue, and truth, which is scarlet. Friendship, love, and truth form the letters, the three core links of the IOOF organization. You will often see the letters F, L, and T. In fact, they're visible here on this lantern, which was lighted and hung outside the building when a meeting was going to be held that particular evening. Those three symbols, friendship, love, and truth, are further symbolized in the three pillars, which is painted on part of the ceiling. The ceiling in this building has been heavily damaged by water leakage when the roof had not been repaired, but a number of them survive, and we'll point them out a little bit later on. Notable previous United States members include William Jennings Bryan, Senator Robert Byrd, Charlie Chaplin, Vice President Schuyler Colfax, Wyatt Earp, Ulysses S. Grant, Warren Harding, Rutherford Hayes, Charles Lindbergh, William McKinley, and Franklin Roosevelt. In Carlisle, they met at two different locations until 1854, when they began renting space in this building, then owned by William Trout. He provided space for the organization to meet here on the third floor. The rental arrangement continued until 1895, when the Oddfellows purchased this building, and following the death of Trout's widow. In 1914, the organization did extensive renovations to the building, including major changes to the large hall on the third floor. However, it's not exactly the room that we're in now. It was later renovated another time. The large hall interior was decorated with murals by local artist John Brott. The large stained glass window on the front of the gable on the facade must have been impressive. A photo of that version of the building is available for view on Facebook. The first and second floors of the building were used for commercial purposes. In 1928, the entire front facade of the building was removed and the current neo-Gothic design was erected. At this time, the lodge hall was again extensively renovated. The vaulted ceiling was put in that you see today, and Brott came back and revised the pictures, this time adding color. This is the space we are standing in today, and a photo of the exterior of the building as it appears now is also posted on Facebook. The Oddfellows sold the building to Pearson Miller and Robert Fry in 1960, but continued to use the space on the third floor until 1991. Cumberland County Historical Society acquired the building in late 2004. In that time, the space on the first floor was rented to Subway. On the western third, Miller's unused office was in the middle, and a ballet supply shop was located in the eastern third of the building. Elizabeth Rhodes wrote a detailed article on the history of the IOOF for a 2005 edition of the Society's journal. In it, she not only talks about the history of the Carlisle organization, but also gives information about the broader history of the organization and the meanings of the many symbols used by them. A careful reading of her article explains the meaning of some of the murals depicted in this room. For example, the picture behind me is, we believe, the biblical story of Isaac and his son and his father Abraham. The mural on the far end of the building is the story of the Good Samaritan, and we're going to pan around to that right now. Some of the murals clearly depict biblical events, particularly those in the upper vault, which are the better surviving ones. We have not entirely figured out the meaning of each. The symbols used by the IOF can still be seen in those paintings. One in particular is the all-seeing eye, which is immediately over my head, but which we're not able to focus on right now. Damage to the ceiling has obliterated some of the symbols. There are 11 stained glass windows, two of them visible now, three flanking the five central windows. When they are completely uncovered, it makes a very dramatic appearance on that side of the room. Other important symbols include the heart and hand, the skull and crossbones, the beehive, the bundle of rods, the arrows, the dove, the serpent, scales, the coffin, the Bible, moon and stars, the tents, the size, the hourglass, the Ark of the Covenant, and the globe in full light. A Sentinel article from 1899 mentions the intention to make extensive modifications to the building. These included removing the rear portion and extending the commercial rooms on the first and second floors, and adding the staircase we now use to reach those two floors. The building, at that point, though it had originally historically been three buildings, was clearly combined into one. Commercial space continued to be rented on the first floor and also to various offices, including the Cumberland County Commissioners and the Cumberland County Board of Education had office space on the second floor, which is now used by a Dickens sorority. The section of the building at 29 West High Street was most often a tobacco shop with a bowling alley behind it. That's the one-story addition behind it. The middle was frequently a bookstore, and this section of the building on the left, where there had been a Subway restaurant, was usually a restaurant or a candy store of some type. So that gives you a general picture of how the building is used. Various occupants, as I have mentioned over the years, have used the space. We've posted some pictures of some of those uses on the website, on Facebook on the website. You can certainly look there. What will be done with this building in the future, we're not sure of. This room needs an extensive amount of renovation to bring it back to being able to be useful. The undergirding of the flooring has to be replaced. Obviously, additional work needs to be done on the ceiling, and an elevator would need to be added. So the specifics of will or how that happen have not been determined.